I'm Elaine. I'm going to go through installing Linux using VirtualBox. I'm going to try to make some things go wrong as well, so it's not all perfect, just in case you experience the very same thing. So the first thing you need is Ubuntu or another Linux distribution. I'm going to use Ubuntu, so you can get that from the Ubuntu website, ubuntu.com. I've chosen Ubuntu 17, which I've pre-downloaded for you already, and I'm going to be able to access that on my local drive. So that's the installation media. Next thing I need to do is open up VirtualBox, which I've already downloaded. It's a freebie from Oracle. And the first thing you do is create yourself a new virtual computer. I'm going to call this Ubuntu 17, and that name will appear on the left hand side. I'm going to keep it at the default setting and do not add a virtual hard disk now. Show you what happens there. So I now have a virtual machine but without any hard disk allocated to it. So if you at some point later on want to go back to do some work on this, you choose settings, which can be accessed from the above menu bar as well, or toolbar. And in there, what I'm looking for is a way to set up the hard disk space. Now, while I'm here, you can set up so you can share the clipboard between the host, which is Windows, and the new Linux virtual machine, and the same for drag and drop. I'm going to leave those for now as they are, but I just thought I'd mention those while we're there. And in this section, it's by default using one of the CPUs that are available on my system. I'm leaving those as defaults as well. The video memory, it's going to use 16 meg of that. You can have a little look around, but I'm leaving most of this at the default, well, all of this at the default, should I say. Storage, I want to use this disk, and so here is where I can add my hard disk for the virtual machine. You're about to add a virtual hard disk to the controller. Would you like to create a new empty file to hold the disk contents? Okay, so create a new disk. And that's where you can create your hard disk. So this could be your Ubuntu 17 HD. That'll almost be like your volume label. And I'm going to choose the default. But if you hadn't done that, I'll show you actually, if you hadn't gone through and added the hard disk, what would happen in a moment. So I haven't added the hard disk, and then I'm going to leave everything else to the default. So network address translation is suitable for 95% of installations, which will almost always include your home installation. So for this, you can gain access to shared folders on your Windows machine, for example. That's quite useful. So leaving it as it is, I'm now going to try to install. I mean, if I'm quite new to this, this is what I might end up doing. Having said that, I probably would leave all of the default settings to what they are. So I'm going to find my ISO image, which is here. That's the installation image. And then starts the installation, and clearly it will complain to me. Tell me I don't have anywhere to install it. Let's see that happen. Just close those, I don't need those messages. But what's going to happen is it's going to run the live version, which allows you to run Ubuntu, but you can't make any changes because it really is just a live demo. That's what's going to happen right now. So it will run, but I won't be able to install it. So I could use Ubuntu as it is without installing it. So I can try it or try to install it. Trying it means it's almost like running it from a CD and you can't make any changes. So let's install Ubuntu. You need at least 8 gig, and this computer has 0, so I have to quit the installation until I allocate the space. So I will do that, and remember I have only chosen 1024 at the moment. I think what I'm going to do is shut this down properly. You should always get into the habit. Look for a cog or something similar in order to be able to close the system down. I know where to go clearly, but you want to shut down the Linux system. I'm now going to install the same version of Ubuntu on the virtual machine, but with low values. So I've deleted Ubuntu 17 that I made earlier, the virtual machine, which I didn't fully install, and I'm starting again. So I'm going to call that Ubuntu 17 and keep that as Linux. Keep the default settings, which I would normally change this, but I want to try and create an issue. And then this will allow you to create your virtual hard disk, which is the hard disk for storing the Linux distribution. So I will go ahead and create that. I'm going to choose something slightly larger than 8 gig, which I think most people would choose. So there's no point in leaving it to the default. And I'm going to choose a virtual machine disk in the hope that I could import it into VMware, but that normally doesn't happen. I want to try and show you that as well. I'm going to let VirtualBox dynamically allocate the space as required rather than have a fixed size. I'm not going to split it into small files, which is what you might do with a FAT partition. So that's my machine. So that's like effectively creating a computer to do my installation from. And then start. Now this bit will be a little slow because I can't control how fast the installation works at. Now I've already located the ISO that I mentioned to you. I'm now going to start the installation. So this is my installation disk. It is quite difficult to simulate problems, but the sort of things that you might encounter are where you haven't enough memory or you haven't enough disk space in your virtual machine. So look for those messages now. When it first starts up, it allows you to just try Ubuntu, so you can't make any changes. It's just a live demo, or you can install it. So let's choose install. And then you can download the updates while installing Ubuntu. Press continue. So this is not a problem because erasing the disk and installing Ubuntu is just going to erase everything from the disk that you've just created. Bearing in mind it's a virtual machine, and so it's only referring to the disk space used for the virtual machine. So you don't have to worry. We're not going to encrypt because it does slow things down, although if you have a high secure system that you're setting up, then you would choose this. I'm just going to simply use the virtual machine and storage that I've just created. So erase the disk. You mustn't worry about this. It's only erasing the disk that is used for your virtual machine. Okay, so now it's going to just take me through standard installation process, which is all quite straightforward. It's already detected that it's English. I'm going to put my name in there. I'll put Elaine Eagles so that it can make my life easy for me and choose a username for me. And I'm going to put a simple password in there, which is not advised if you were going to seriously use this. I'm not going to log in automatically. I'm going to require my password to allow me to log in. But yes, you would choose a better password. This is purely for testing purposes. Now it's going to spend some time copying the files, and I will pause that for a moment. But just out of interest, while this is installing, I used to install Linux on a dual boot on a separate partition, and then you could boot into Linux or you could choose to boot into Windows. But I tend to use the virtual machine nowadays because then you can keep working using your standard office applications like Word and PowerPoint, and use your standard video recording and screencasting software whilst actually working with Linux. And I find that running it on my Mac as well as on my Windows machine, I can easily flip between the two different operating systems. So I can also share data on the Windows machine with my Linux partition, or sorry, with my Linux virtual machine, which is great for trying to make worksheets whilst also teaching, demonstrating what to do. So it's quite handy. It's now configuring the system. You might have an old laptop that you want to use so that you can set yourself up a Linux machine and use that for browsing and various other tasks, email, basic image editing. You can do a lot on Linux without even needing to have a Windows installation. But just to give you an idea, I mean, this is a nice, easy way of getting yourself some experience with it at least. You might find that you really like using it. You might find it doesn't do everything you need. I think one of the main problems is the gaming platform. It's not really built for that. Although you can get some games on there, but it's not really about gaming. Just get yourself as much experience with it as possible because Linux is heavily used in the industry. And there are some companies that deal mostly with Microsoft, and that's fine, but some you will find work across platforms, across operating systems. So it is good to get yourself some experience with this. Sorry about that OneDrive for Business. I need to sort that out, but hopefully that's not too distracting. I'll probably edit it out. Right, still taking its time, but you got some interesting things to read while you're waiting around for it, and it's just shown you there some things about you, some YouTube videos. You'll see you get LibreOffice and Calc, so that's a spreadsheet. You get Impress, which is PowerPoint, or like PowerPoint. Sorry, I know it isn't PowerPoint, but you can actually save between the two programs. So LibreOffice is like Word. I've been known to use these programs instead of Microsoft's. And so if you're using a shared disk between Linux and Windows or Linux and the Mac, then you may find you can just open and close your documents between the two. But do be careful and make sure you have backups. So that didn't take too long. When it says you need to restart the computer, by the way, that just means restart the virtual machine. To avoid you sitting and watching this, it took a very long time to start. In fact, it didn't start, and this is probably due to the low memory, which I selected as 1024. I wouldn't keep this and I wouldn't have installed it like this, but as said, I'm trying to show you examples of where you might have just selected all the defaults. So go back, redo it. As you can see, it didn't take too long. I mean, I know I paused the video whilst the installation took place, but it actually didn't take long at all. I started it about 10 to 3 and the whole process finished by 1:15. So that 20, 25 minutes at the maximum. So if it all goes horribly wrong, just remove it, remove all files, and then you can start again. And make sure you give it, say, two processor cores as well, which is reasonable. I have 8 on my system, and so it's only fair to give it about two of those whilst running in another operating system. So remember that the virtual machine will be running in the context of another system, but if that system's not being used as much as the Linux one, then you might want to think about giving it more processor cores and more memory. But also consider how many virtual machines you're going to have on the system as well. You may end up with a number of virtual machines. So you might find that you actually like this system and You can do your online banking and other more secure online activities using it instead of your Windows platform. So let's go and make another one. I'll now go and remove the virtual machine, which can be done from the machine menu, remove, or you can right click the virtual machine and remove it that way. So I'm going to remove all the files as well. So that's all gone, and create a new one. I'm going to call it Ubuntu 17 again. And this time I'm going to give more memory. I'm going to create the virtual hard disk now, why not? I'm going to choose the file location for that so that I can locate it on my E drive in my, actually I'm going to choose a different location. I'm going to call that VirtualBox. I won't use that one. I want VirtualBox Machines. That's where I want to place my virtual machine. That way I'll be able to go and find that whenever I need to. I can then copy that to another disk and carry it around with me. So save that. So that's where it's going to be now. Make sure you change that to a place where you will be able to find it later. I'm going to increase this to a more reasonable value, probably something like 60. Probably won't need 60 gigabytes, but I'll choose that anyway. I'm going to choose a virtual machine disk, but I will show you that it's still quite difficult to be able to export. Actually, no, I'll choose a virtual box disk image and see if I can export and import into VMware. I'll do that. Right, so I have my virtual machine, and I'll go into the settings. And I'll also change some of these things. First of all, I'm happy with these, the naming. I would like to share the clipboard bidirectionally, and I would like to drag and drop bidirectionally, which means my Linux, anything I do in Linux, I should be able to then make available to my Windows system, which is very useful. A small description, testing the Ubuntu installation, and you can put on here 4 gig of memory. I think I gave it about 60 gig of hard disk. So you can put the details in there if you wish. And I'm going to have details of test. It doesn't matter for the password. It doesn't matter. I'm not going to distribute this to across the internet or make it available across the internet. So I'm going to start this because I don't want to set anything else. I'm going to leave everything else as the default. I'm going to choose the location of the ISO disk again, just like before, which is luckily I know where it already is. I've been there before, so it just came up. So make sure you know where all your files are. And this is going to again boot into the live system like it did before. So I will just pause and let that happen. I will go and try and install this straight away. Download updates while installing is quite useful. Get it to install all the drivers straight away and install any graphics, Wi-Fi and so on all at the same time. So it'll build up a repository of links to the Ubuntu software distribution servers. I don't really need to worry about this because there's nothing on the hard disk. Remember, it's the hard disk that's dedicated to the virtual machine, so don't worry. I don't want to encrypt it. I'm not really worried about anything else, so I could make the partitions myself. And if you were trying to mimic an existing system that you were developing for, then you would do this. It's a good thing to do when you're more advanced, because you might have more than one disk or more than one disk controller, in which case that's perfect for you to split up the data from the server applications and so on. But we're going to just keep it simple. So So there's nothing to erase, but we'll choose that option anyway. Again, it's just giving you a message to say, are you sure? Yes. Just go ahead and do it because there's nothing on that new hard disk. And now choose the defaults. Again, it's told me I'm in the UK, which is great. Don't need to think about it. Or scroll. I'm going to choose student. And the password of test. I wouldn't choose test if you were going to seriously use this system for more things. I might change it later anyway, so it doesn't matter. I can change the password later. I would like to use the password when I log in. By choosing student, I can then distribute this virtual machine to everyone, and you don't have to log in with my username. So that's quite helpful. I'll pause this a few times so you don't have to sit there watching files being copied again. This might take another couple of minutes while it's in configuring and doing various other downloads from the distribution of repositories. So it's retrieving 99 files. In case you're wondering how it's doing all of this, it's using shell scripts, and that's something that I'll do a video on shortly, all of which can be done manually, step by step, and you can reconfigure your system later easily. So as you can see at the bottom, it's doing various cleanup operations right now, just removing some of the installation files that are no longer needed. It's run a couple of scripts as well and some commands. All of this via a script. One of the good things about Ubuntu is there's a significant amount of support and a large community of developers. This is open source, remember. People who contribute could be academics and people from business and just individuals from a community. So the installation has been completed and I need to restart this machine, the virtual machine, in order to use it, which I'll do now. See how long that takes. You might as well see all of this. I don't want to remove the installation media, so I'll press enter and just indicate that I've done so because I haven't got a CD to remove. And let's see how long this one takes to start up. Say it's now doing a clean up without having booted the operating system. It was in bootstrap mode at that time. Hopefully that'll be quick and I'll be able to log in very soon, but obviously the first time I run it, it might take a little while. So for student, I can click. With the last installation, I didn't get this at all. I couldn't get to it, so I just shut down the system and deleted it. So I can now get in, but just see how quickly it runs on the 4 gig with the 60 gig of hard disk space. First time is always a bit slow, so what I'll do is I'll close it down and then reboot it. I'll do that now and see if it's any quicker. So I'm going to straight away shut down the system and restart it. See how long that takes. Did a little system check at the beginning, which is where it's giving you the clean message that it's run a file system check, which if you had not shut the system down on a regular basis, it may have to do a significant amount of checking and fixing first before it can run the operating system. That's the typical speed, and that's without any additional services to start. Have a look around. You've got your files, you've got the LibreOffice, which is a bit like Word. LibreOffice Calc is like Excel, and Impress is like the database access, and your other software is on here, so you can install more things. Let's have a quick look. So it's downloading this library from the software repositories. Now you can install your software for directly from the command line. That's taking its time. I think that might be because I set the graphics driver to quite a low amount. So I might actually go back shortly and increase that as well. Now, if I want to have a terminal window, what you normally would do is super user do apt get update to update your operating system when you first get it. It's always good to check if there's anything else, so run the upgrade and update and it will see whether you need to add anything extra. It actually is downloading and unpacking various updates, and you might think, well, I've just installed the latest distribution, but that was packaged up and made available via a website some time ago. And in the meantime, updates have been made, which could be over the last week or 2 weeks, and therefore you want to go ahead and get those. You want to do this quite regularly. So this is like an update on Windows, but you have control, so you can decide when to do this. So I ran the apt get update. I'll go ahead and write that in a slide, and then you can have a look at that more clearly while this is happening. So there are the commands that you need to run. Super user do is what sudo is, and you'll be asked for your password. That's still going, so there's quite a lot of upgrades and updates to be made. It's best to do this before adding anything new. It already has Python by default, I noticed, on there, which is good. So one of the things you need to do when you have your system installed and updated, upgraded, etc., is to start looking at what is already on the system before you need to obviously try to install the things that you need. I know you'll want to have Python with the idle editor, maybe Eclipse for coding, and a web server. As a student there, that's a typical environment that you would benefit from. So that's what I'll be installing in the next video. So that's just finished, and I'll have a little look around and just see if I have Python. Where is Python? And there it is. So I can see that I do have Python 3 and 2 on there. And there's a couple of little things that I can check. So in user bin, I can look in the directory for Python. Anything with Python, grep will search. So it will give me a listing, a long list, and pipe the output from the listing into the grep, which is the search facility, and just pull back anything to do with Python. And I can now see from this that Python 3.5 is what I have on the system, and I also have Python 2.7, and that is always kept because there are many scripts still using 2.7. Python itself, if you just run that on its own, I'm just trying to find, is linking to Python 2.7. So if you run Python on its own to run a script, it would run the old editor. So you may want to consider that you have to use 3.5 or change this. This is just a link, like a shortcut on Windows. So I'm happy that I've got Python. What I don't think I have is, I don't think I have idle, but we'll have a quick check for that. No, I don't have idle, so I might need to go over and reinstall some more Python, so add a few more Python programs. So I think that's just the core Python on there. Close that. Okay, so that's the system out of the box. It runs reasonably well. For my next installation, I will increase the graphics driver memory that I have available, just to speed that up a little bit, because I am using a graphical interface. And that's pretty much what you get out of the box. Hopefully that's helped.